talking about love and loving wide open, what that looks like, what that means. Jesus said this thing in John chapter 15, that there's no greater love than one who lays down their life for one's friend. No greater love. In beings that tomorrow is Memorial Day, I thought it would be a good thing in recognition of that scripture. If you are an active in military, if you are a veteran, if you know somebody that's important to you, that you love, who may have fallen serving this country, would you just please stand up right now? We want to recognize and say thank you to those who have served our country selflessly. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for your service. Yeah. You know, we talked about last weekend about the world's perspective and from the world's definition of love and what that was. And, you know, we talked about what love wasn't. Does anybody remember what we said, what love is not? Love is not a, anybody? Feeling. Who said the feeling? Oh, good for you. Way to go. That's awesome. Love is not a feeling. Showed you a snapshot of a Google search page. Do you remember that? And next to the word love, it said this. It said it was an intense feeling of deep affection. But then when we read the scripture that I just quoted in John chapter 15, verse 12, which says there's no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends, we determined that love is not a feeling, that love was more of an intense commitment to unconditional sacrifice. Unconditional sacrifice. And then we also determined that there were certain characteristics that described true love, and that instead of a feeling, we saw in Scripture that true love was a decision. It was a choice. That it was a law. That it was an act of the will, and that it was a debt that we owed to one another. Do you guys remember that? Those were the things that we described true love as. And then we wrapped up last week's message by realizing just how much God really loves us. It was said by Jesus himself in a prayer that he prayed to the Father shortly before he was crucified. He prayed this statement to the Father saying, "May they," meaning us, "may they experience such perfect unity that the world will know, number one, that you sent me, and number two, that you love them as much as you love me." What a magnificent thing. I hope that resonated in your minds and in your hearts all week long, to know that the creator of the universe, the one who spoke existence into being, loves you as much as he loves his own son, Jesus. That's big. And then at the end of my message last week, I made this statement, and I want to reiterate it because I think it could be taken wrong. My encouragement was this: instead of striving as Christians, okay, here are my words, instead of striving as Christians to show love to a hurting world, that we would instead just be love to a hurting world. And there's a difference. That was Jesus. That's how he lived his life on earth, and that's how he continues to live his life in heaven. He is love. Let me give us an example. Take something that you like to do, whether it's, I don't know, just choose. Biking, hunting, fishing. Jim, what do you like to do? RVing. Okay, RVing. So we can show somebody what it's like to RV. We can talk about it all day long. Jürgen, you know how, what it's like to go RVing, right? We can try to explain to somebody what it feels like to be out on the open road, just you and the road and the RV. Freedom, right? To be set up at camp or in an RV park and just, you know, the openness of just being not at work, but being with your RV. We could even go down to the local RV store. We can oogle over all the new RVs. We can touch them and feel them and sit in them and get behind the wheel and do all that kind of stuff, right? We can try to show somebody what it means to go RVing. Or we could just put somebody in our RV and go RVing and let them experience for themselves what it means to go RVing. Hopefully, they would experience the richness of RVing to the point of, hey, I'm going to go buy my own RV. I'm going to go license it. I'm going to learn all about the dumping of all the tanks and all of that good stuff that we love to do. We're going to really learn what it means to RV, right? And then we can go RVing together, right? That's kind of what I'm trying to get across to us. We can show somebody what true love is all about, or we can just be true love to somebody. Does that make sense? Are you tracking with me? So whether it's RVing, fishing, whether it's the Christian life, or whether it's true love, at some point it's not enough just to show someone love. Jesus said, I have appointed you to go and produce lasting fruit. Lasting fruit. And if lasting love is what we're after here, then we have to be that kind of love. Yes? Amen. And here's the really cool part, church. Being that kind of love to someone is really cool. When you get to the place in your life when you just are love to someone, I call it realizing true love. Realizing true love. If we listen to what the world says that true love is, we can completely miss the realization of God's true love for us. The foundation of realizing true love is where we find our roles as humans. In the context of true love, realizing true love means three things. It means realizing who we are, number one. Realizing who Jesus really is. And then realizing who the Father is. And Jesus tells us who we are and who he is by way of analogy, which is why I've asked you to turn to John chapter 15. He compares us and our relationship with him and the Father, and maybe even more importantly, their relationship towards us, to that of a grapevine. A grapevine. In John chapter 15, verse 5, Jesus says that we are the branches. He says, I am the vine, you are the branches. He describes us as the branches. In John chapter 15, verse 1, Jesus says, I am the true grapevine. And then right after that, he says, and my Father is the gardener. Okay? So we're the branches, Jesus is the vine, and his Father is the gardener. And then Jesus says this. He says, his Father, the gardener, cuts off every branch that doesn't produce fruit and prunes the branches that does produce fruit, which we'll get to here in just a minute later on in the message. But what I want us to focus on right now is this question. Why does Jesus use the grapevine as an analogy for producing fruit in the Christian life, especially as it pertains to love? I mean, why this whole comparison between the gardener, the vine, and the branches for the purpose of what seems to be really important to Jesus? The fruit. The fruit. So what I thought I would do while I was, you know, studying and meditating and praying on this message last week, I thought, man, what a great analogy, right? A vineyard. And, you know, the vine and the canopy of the grapes and all that. What better way to really learn about what Jesus is trying to show us visually than to go out to a vineyard? We have plenty of them around here, did you know? And I have a friend, his name is Jamie. He owns a vineyard called Jackson, locally here, and went out to see Jamie. I called him up last week and said, hey, can I just come out and you just kind of show me what this whole thing is? He said, yeah, sure, come on out. And we just, you know, and I apologize for the video. I shot it with my iPhone, and I didn't turn it like you've got yours right now, and it's the skinny version. I'm sorry. It's a little shaky, but the content is there. So take a look, okay? So Pastor Jimmy and Vintner Jamie here at Jackson Vineyards, and you know, we're in John 15, and he says that Jesus says that he is the true vine. And I thought, you know, what a better way to pick up on what Jesus is talking about than to come out here and see what a true vine looks like and what it means to abide or remain. Jamie, would you give us just a little bit of a...
Sure. I'll point something out here. So these vines were grafted over after 3 years. So they were considered mature vines at the time. They were bearing fruit. And but we did a graft union because we wanted to change over to a different varietal. And so I'll just speak exactly what the process was. So this is an old trunk right here. We grafted over here. And when you do that, this is the new graft union. This is the original graft union. So these have been grafted twice, but this is the original graft union. This is rootstock that is basically disease resistant, and it kind of controls the amount of growth. So there's a little union here. When we did this, we changed the varietal. We went from Tempranillo to Grenache. And when we did this, one of the things that we had to do was bleed the vines. They have so much pressure with this mature, had so much energy in the roots, stored carbohydrates, that it would literally push the graft union out.
Is that called hydraulic pressure?
Hydraulic pressure, right. So right here, if you can see these notches, this was where we had to bleed this particular vine.
Why is it important to bleed?
To release the pressure and or it would push the union apart. That's really how it was explained to me. And so grafting isn't something that we do all the time. We usually start with an initial graft of from rootstock to the varietal that we're wanting to grow. But sometimes we can always graft at another time. And that's when the bleeding is definitely necessary because of the amount of pressure from the mature vine to the immature one. It would overwhelm it, so you have to bleed it. It develops into a trunk, cordon, and spurs where the fruit is renewed every year. There's an amazing amount of pruning that goes on and training to get this structure that you can manage the canopy of the vineyard. But particular every year, these green growing shoots become canes when they become dormant, and they get pruned every year. And that creates high quality fruit. Otherwise, they would bear a lot of fruit, but it would not be of quality. It would be of no flavor, would not have the quality that you're looking for in quality wine. Mm-hmm. It would be more like table grapes at best.
Yeah. Why is the pruning process so important for the fruit?
Without it, it'll just be, the plant will just create a big old, I don't know, for lack of a better word, a big shaggy mess, and it'll try to overproduce this fruit but with no quality or depth. So you have to prune. You're looking for a balanced plant. Balance is the balance between canopy and the amount of fruit that it produces. If we didn't prune these two clusters here they're young right now and they haven't flowered, but they would be a new shoot out of every junction here, and the plant would quadruple or whatever, go 10 times the size, and it would not have the capacity to ripen quality fruit if it was unpruned. So you have to prune every year. There's just no there's no alternative.
Yeah.
Even here is a shoot thinning. See here, there's three here.
Yes.
I'm going to remove this right now. There's pruning even in when they're green growing. This is two. That was an additional. Here's another one. This is another. I mean, that's why there's so much handwork in the grapes. But we were looking for two and not three. So
when you say handwork in grapes, what do you mean by that? They require what?
A lot of attention. There's nothing. Yeah, everything that you can. When you're looking at this structure here and this canopy and the trellis system, you're trying to train things. So it's just like everything else. It takes discipline. It takes a plan, and it needs a lot of attention. Just like our relationship with the Lord, you really have to be in the vines daily to know what's going on.
Right.
I have to be out here every day, or in a matter of a week. Things are, I'm behind, and
really,
yes,
yeah.
So
it can get on top of you really quick.
Oh, it can. Yeah.
So as it pertains to the Bible, Jamie, mm-hmm. Jesus says that he's the vine. Mm-hmm. This part.
Yep.
He said, and he says his father, which mm-hmm. in this analogy would be you. You're the gardener,
mm-hmm.
and he describes us as the branches,
mm-hmm. right? Cordons, cordons, huh?
And that he. He wants us to remain in him so that we produce much fruit.
Right.
And in order to do that, it takes lots of hands-on.
Hands-on.
Lots of care. Lots of maybe discipleship.
Discipleship.
What does that mean in a young vine's life?
It's definitely the training. They would have no structure. The structure and the direction that they grow would be uncontrolled. So you have to have them. If we look over at these younger vines here, they had to be tied, they had to be trained to go up, they had to be, you know, knowing that this canopy and this trellis system was designed for them, they wouldn't know how to do it without the farmer's hand basically teaching them how to be tied to the stake, how to the shape that they want. And then not trying to spread themselves too thin. That's the pruning process. We want quality fruit. We can't have ourself going in too many directions. And I think that's just another analogy of life, that if we become too distracted with too many things, we're never going to bear the quality fruit that that the Lord has for us. So, yeah.
What an analogy.
Yeah, and these are, they're called little suckers. So just like little thorns in our side and little things that bother us of life, they need to come off, for more balanced structure. So isn't that the truth, how things pop up?
It really
and,
is.
Absolutely. I see it in my daily life, both in the vineyard and, of course, in my walk with Christ. So
that's awesome. You know, the Apostle Paul tells us in Romans chapter 11 that we as Gentiles, we were not born into the family like the Jewish people, right? And so when they rejected God, he made his salvation available to everyone. But that since we were not born into the family, we have been grafted into the family.
Right.
And don't you find that that's the case down here?
Yeah.
The grafting
here's this is a third year vine, and you see it's getting stronger. I showed you one of the first year was as small as my finger here, and then this is that union, graft union, and getting stronger. The training is this one has been trained over the last couple of years. It's now going to bear fruit this year.
First year fruit?
Yep, first year of real considerable fruit.
How many years does it usually take to get usable fruit?
Third year is really the first, I would say, usable fruit. You can get a little bit of second year fruit, but for the most part, 3-4 years, and you've pretty much trained up the grapevine.
Wow.
But if you don't maintain, it will go away, just like our walk. If we're not maintaining, our walk can slip, and we know about that.
So. Great. Jamie, thanks a bunch for taking the time today. We really appreciate it. What an analogy. And man, if you guys get a chance, come on out to Jackson Vineyards.
Isn't that cool? I know that there's a lot there. Yep. There's a lot there. But what I want to bring to our attention was in the first part of the video, he talked about the bleeding. Did you catch that? Jesus says that that's him.
And to understand the grafting process that we as Gentiles is what I tried to get to in the video. Didn't quite capture it in the video, but we're grafted into the family of God. Jesus calls himself the vine, the true vine, right? And that since the Jewish people, they rejected Jesus, God cut them off. And now we, and he offers salvation to all who, what, believe, right? And in order for us to be grafted into the vine, what had to happen? So that the hydraulic pressure, right, the nourishment of God, didn't push us out from the vine, that we are grafted in. It had to be bled to relieve that pressure. Isn't that an amazing analogy? That literally to this very day, when they graft new varietals onto the vine, they cut the bark, they open it up, they put the bud, the new grafting bud into it, they wrap it very, very tightly, so much so that even oxygen can't get to the marrying of the two, and then they take a saw and they cut the vine so that it bleeds, so as not to push the graft away. Isn't that an amazing analogy? And that's what Jesus says he is. The other thing that he says is that he wants us to bear lasting fruit. We talked about that already. He says, I appointed you to go and produce lasting fruit. Now, most people would say that this fruit that Jesus is talking about is winning souls for the kingdom. But it's much more than that. It can be that, but it's much more. In this context, it shows up as answered prayer. Look at verse 7 in John chapter 15. Verse 7 says, but if you remain in me and my words remain in you, you may ask for anything you want and it'll be granted. So answered prayer. The other thing that shows up in this context is joy, and not only just joy, but joy that overflows. Verse 11. Look at verse 11. He says, I have told you these things so that you will be filled with my joy. And then he says, yes, your joy will overflow. But if we turn to Galatians 5, verse 22, the Apostle Paul gives us a complete list of what the fruit is. So what is the fruit? Did anybody learn this song in kids' church? Right? Paul says the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And I will be the first one to raise my hand and say, I need help with that last one. How about you? Yeah. I want us to notice how love is always at the forefront of everything. Whether Jesus is teaching his disciples or whether the Apostle Paul is speaking to the first century church, love is always considered to be the priority over all other priorities. And at the end of 1 Corinthians 13, which is also known as the love chapter, Paul says three things will last forever: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love, right? So based on Scripture, one could surmise that the greatest fruit would be love. And if we go back and look at verse 16 of John chapter 15, there's this word that changes the analogy from the natural to the spiritual, right? We all know that in this case, fruit, which are the grapes, have a shelf life, don't they? Especially after harvest, when you pick the fruit, you've only got so much time to consume it. Otherwise, it spoils, it decays. But Jesus says in verse 16, I have appointed you to go and produce lasting fruit. Lasting fruit. And that word lasting has been translated from the other words that we see in this same passage, remain or abide, which in the Greek is the word meno. We talked about that last weekend. In this context, it's the parameno Greek word, which means to remain beside. That's a part of the lasting fruit. It's to remain beside or to be attached to. So not only does Jesus say he wants us to remain or abide in him, but that the fruit we produce will also never die. It'll never die. It too will also remain beside or be attached to him. And so what's the fruit? We have to get this very clear. It's not people. What he's talking about here is love. It's what we are to people. So why is it so important to Jesus that we produce much fruit? Well, there are two reasons, and they're found in verse 8 of this passage. Number one, when you produce much fruit, you are my true disciples. My true disciples. So producing much fruit, which in this context is love, Jesus says, proves that you are his true disciples. And then the second reason, it's important, Jesus says, it brings great glory to my Father. Really important to Jesus. Jesus says, the gardener of the vineyard is glorified when there's a lot of lasting fruit being produced. Now, the opposite of that is also true. Let's talk for a moment about those who choose not to remain or abide in the true grapevine. And I have to confess, I struggled with this one, church. I struggled with it in a really big way. Because I'm kind of an eternally secure kind of a person. That's what I've been taught. That's what I believe, that I'm eternally secure in my salvation. I hold tightly to Romans 8:38 that tells us there's nothing that can separate us from the love of God. Amen? But teaching this passage of Scripture, it brings up some various and very serious questions with regards to eternal security because of the language used by Jesus. What do I mean by that? Well, from my studies last week, there seems to be two camps, okay? There's the once saved, always saved camp, which is where I like to be. And then there's the other camp that says that you can lose your salvation. John chapter 15 is one of these passages of Scripture that brings this question up due to the nature of Jesus' words as he's teaching his disciples using the vine comparison. More specifically, take a look at verse 2 with me. Jesus says, he, meaning the gardener or the Father, cuts off every branch of mine that produces fruit. He prunes the branches that do bear fruit, so they will produce even more. Okay? So there's the language. And then if we look down at verse 6, Jesus says this, anyone who does not remain in me is thrown away like a useless branch and withers. Such branches are gathered into a pile to be burned. And therein lies the question, doesn't it? It raises the question in my own heart. Can we lose our salvation? It's a big question. If we become Christians who are not in Jesus, will the Father cut us off the vine and cast us away to be burned in the fire? That's the question that I wrestled with all week long. Because at first glance, doesn't it seem as if the answer is yes? He cuts off and throws us into the fire, which flies in the face of everything I've ever believed or been taught about eternal security. So as I wrestled and I prayed and I asked God, Lord, please give me something for this weekend that will answer the question, will you cut me off the vine if I don't remain or abide? And as I dug in, I felt the Holy Spirit say, yes, but it's not what you think. It's not what you think. So keep digging. Keep studying. Dig into the truth of my word. So I did. I dug in. And what really bothered me, church, was this language of cutting off. Doesn't that bother you? this language of being cut off and cast aside, disregarded, to be withered, dried up, and then thrown into the fire. So I went back to the original text. And what I found was very interesting. What I found is that at first glance, it seems that Jesus is talking about two different kinds of branches here, right? That's what I thought. The branch that he cuts off and disregards, that it withers and dries up and he's going to burn it. And then there's the other one that he just prunes so that it produces more fruit. That's what I thought. So we either remain in Christ to be pruned by the Father, or he will cut us off and throw us into hell. Is that what he's saying here? Look at verse 2 again. There are two sets of branches that Jesus says are in him. He says he cuts off every branch of mine, that doesn't produce fruit. Jesus is actually telling us that there are three types of branches here. This was so revolutionary in my way of thinking. Not just two branches, but three. That these branches are in him. Secondly, this is very important. The words cut off in the original text are the words he takes away. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. Now, that expression, he takes away, comes from the Greek word airo, spelled A-I-R-O, pronounced airo, which means, and listen to this, to raise up, to elevate, to be lifted up. That's what cut off means in this context. You see, in first century viticulture, it was a well-known fact if you had a branch that was not bearing fruit, what did you do? Like we saw in the video, you grab it and you lift it up and you put it back in the trellis where it can be exposed to the sun so that it can flower and bear fruit. And so in this context, Jesus is saying to those believers, okay, they're saved. Those believers who do not produce fruit will be elevated. They'll be lifted up so that they can be exposed to the Son of God. For the purpose of, watch this, for training, retraining, for correction, and even discipline if needed. So cutting off is not being hacked off and tossed into hell. Cutting off in this context is being lifted up for training and correction and even discipline. That's much different than being hacked off and thrown into hell, isn't it? So yes, our eternal security is secure as long as we remain in him. Now, there's a second type of branch that he's talking about, and that is the abiding branch. Those of us who are in Jesus, we don't get a free ride here. There's pruning that goes on. Listen to what Jesus says. He says, he prunes the branches that do bear fruit so that they will produce even more. See, even when we're healthy Christians and we're producing fruit, Jesus says that the Father comes along and he says, hey, Jim, guess what? You've got these little areas in your life. These little sucker branches, they're not producing any fruit in your life, so I'm just going to go, I'm going to prune you a little bit. Snip, cut here and there. I'm just going to prune that off of you. And anybody who's ever been pruned as a believer knows that at the very least, it's uncomfortable. And at the very most, it's just downright painful. Right? Anybody been pruned? Yeah. Then Jesus talks about another branch in verse 6. And this is the branch that I got confused with the first branch. This is the branch that he says, anyone who does not remain in me is thrown away like a useless branch and withers. This is the unbelieving branch. This is the one who rejects Christ and does not remain or abide in him and never has chosen him. These are the folks who have never been saved and never intend to be saved. I brought us a little graph this morning, church, to help us realize this. I'm a visual person, and so I want to help you understand what I just taught. Go ahead and throw up that graph if you would. Branch number one, every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. He takes away, is lifted up, elevated, right? They're a believer, they're in Christ, they're saved, but there's no fruit. God lifts them up so that they can learn to bear fruit through training, retraining, correction, and discipline. Okay, God's love. Branch number two, that's where we want to be. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes it so that it may bear more fruit. Believer bears fruit. God prunes, snip, snip, so that they can bear more fruit for him. Right? And remember, the fruit is love. We want to be full of love. Branch number three, that's not where we want to be. It may be people in your life that you know that are not saved. Anyone who does not abide in me, he is thrown away as a branch and dries up. They gather them, cast them into the fire to be burned. Non-believer, no fruit. God judges them for not being in Christ. Does that make things more clear for you? It did for me. It makes clear that cutting off statement by Jesus. It doesn't mean that as believers, we're cut off from the branch. We are saved. Hallelujah and amen. Anybody? So as we can see, no matter where you find yourself on the branch graph, Jesus makes it clear that nothing is possible apart from him. Nothing is possible apart from him. John chapter 15, verse 5, he says, for apart from me, you can do nothing. Nothing. Now, I brought us another visual this morning. This is a branch. I was pulling out of my driveway this morning. I just thought, oh, you know, that'd be a cool little thing to bring in front of the church. Just snapped off a branch. Now, let me ask you a question about this branch. It looks pretty healthy. Do you think it has a chance? No? Why? Because it's not connected to its source, huh? Not anymore. How about bearing fruit? Do you think this thing has any chance of bearing any fruit? No, in fact, thanks. No, it's smarty down here. No, it's a maple tree. Well, let's say it was a grapevine. Do you think there's any chance of any fruit growing on this vine? Or maybe it was an apple tree. No, in fact, it's not only going to not produce any fruit, this thing's going to wither up and die because it has no vine to be attached to. There's no source. There's no nourishment going into this thing anymore. And yet, I see so many Christians living this way. They walk around confessing, I'm a Christian, and yet they are completely severed from the vine. It doesn't work. It just doesn't work. You know, we could even gather around this thing. I could come down front here and we could all gather around it, lay our hands on it, and just pray. We could work really hard at getting this thing to produce some fruit. But it's not going to happen, is it? For those of us who are in Christ, can I just encourage us today? Let the Father prune you. Let him prune you. Let him in. Let him show you those areas in your life where you need a little snipping. Let him prune those non-producing little sucker vines in your life. True love means being pruned. He prunes the branches that do bear fruit so that they will produce even more. See, he doesn't do it, church,
because he wants to cause us pain. He knows it's painful. But he allows it so that we can be the best version of his son here on earth to others. Okay, one more thing I want to talk about this morning. I think it's very important for us to realize this, and then I'll wrap up with a question. But that thing is this. We talked about it in the video a little bit. We are not born saved. Did you know that? If you don't believe it and you have children and they're 2 years old, there's proof. We are not born saved. We are born into sin. But here's the beauty. We are grafted into God's family. And I explained a little bit about that grafting process. What do I mean by that? Well, in Romans chapter 11, Paul begins to talk about this grafting in process, and he uses the same language as Jesus in John chapter 15, but it's not the grapevine. He's talking about an olive tree. He's talking about an olive tree. And so real quick, if you just turn over in your Bibles to Romans chapter 11, I'd like us to read together verses 17 through 24. Verses 17 through 24. And listen to Paul's words. And as we read these words, kind of keep in the back of your mind Jesus' words about the vine. Paul says this, "But some of these branches from Abraham's tree, some of the people of Israel, in other words, have been broken off. And you Gentiles were branches from a wild olive tree. You've been grafted in. So now you also receive the blessing God has promised Abraham and his children, sharing in the rich nourishment from the root of God's special olive tree. But you must not brag about being grafted into replace the branches that were broken off. You're just a branch. You're not the root." Okay? So what's he saying here? He says, don't get a little heady. Don't get cocky here. "You must not brag about being grafted in to replace the branches that were broken off. You were just the branch, not the root. Well, you may say, those branches were broken off to make room for me. Yes, but remember, those branches were broken off because they didn't believe in Christ, and you are there because you do believe. So don't think highly of yourself, but fear what could happen. For if God did not spare the original branches, he won't spare you either. Notice how God is both kind and severe. He is severe towards those who disobeyed, but kind to you if you continue to trust in his kindness. But if you stop trusting, you also will be cut off." There's that word again, cut off. But it doesn't mean hacked and thrown into hell. He's going to lift you up and expose you to the Son of God so that you can be retrained and corrected and disciplined lovingly. "And if the people of Israel turn from their unbelief, they will be grafted in again. For God has the power to graft them back into the tree." Now listen to this. "You, by nature, were a branch cut from a wild olive tree. So if God was willing to do something contrary to nature by grafting you into his cultivated tree, he will be far more eager to graft the original branches back into the tree where they belong." See, church, do you hear his heart? His heart is that no one perish, not even those who reject him. And he has the power to graft anybody back in that wants to, as long as we choose to believe. And so here's the question I want to leave us today. What have you attached yourself to? Think about that. What have you attached yourself to? And I would just encourage us that if it's anything other than Jesus, we've got some issues. Here's my encouragement. If you want to love wide open, attach yourself to the vine. Stay there. Abide. Remain in Jesus. Amen? Amen. Let's pray.